let me just talk to you a little bit about leadership, and as it was said here, give a chance for you to ask some questions, because I think a dialogue is always more effective than somebody simply speaking. And so, just thanks for inviting me to this luncheon. I was looking for some place to eat lunch. As the guy said, don't call me late, but just call me to lunch. I really do appreciate that, to have a retired Army soldier get a chance to talk to you, leaders within the community, because it's an honor for me to be here today. From a broad sense, all of us have experienced leadership from really two perspectives or both. We either have been led or we are a leader. And from that vantage point, all of us develop our own ideas and experiences and how we might want to lead. And I'm not going to stand up here and pretend to you that I have some kind of magic formula that I can give you that will solve the great question of what makes a good leader. Now, I trust that over the next couple of minutes, I'll stimulate your thinking a little bit, and perhaps we can have a short dialogue about leadership or some of the things I've said, and I would encourage you to challenge anything that I lay out here for you today. By using this format, I think that we'll have a better exchange. You'll get to know me, and maybe I'll get to know a little bit more about you and your ministry that you have in the community, because I think that's so vitally important in our communities today. As an aside, I thought that it was interesting coincidence today that today marks the 100th anniversary for our nation's entry into World War I today.
Wow.
100 years ago today. That was billed as the war to end all wars. And of course, we know that is not true in what we see today and what happened after that. But certainly, there were some great military leaders who came out of World War I as junior officers that would go on to lead our military during World War II. Names like Generals Marshall, Patton, and MacArthur, just to name a few. Eisenhower, of course, did not deploy to World War I, but he was close behind them, one of our great military leaders. And they went on to take the lessons that they learned as officers in World War I and the time between the wars, and went on into higher rank and positions of responsibility. Of course, the rest is history about how our nation basically saved the world. Yes. So that again, our nation saved the world during World War II. We didn't do it alone, and certainly today you cannot fight alone, but our nation was the primary reason that we were successful as a civilization in the Second World War. And that kind of leads me to one of my first observations about leadership that I believe is important. I'm talking about those leaders that continue to advance post-World War I. That is that if you want to be a good leader, it's important to study other leaders. Now, for me, of course, I studied the great military leaders of the past, but I also study some of our most important political leaders, such as Lincoln, Roosevelt, Truman, and most recently, I'm reading about Winston Churchill. And if you haven't read much about Winston Churchill and his leadership, you just need to do it, especially during the World War II era. The leadership styles of these leaders, both good and bad, everybody has negatives and positives, and the manner in which they led in peace and war were instrumental in developing my leadership style and provided me with a vivid picture of how a leader solves complex problems, but more importantly, gets his people to excel. Mm-hmm. That's what leadership is really all about, is getting people to excel. And in combat, it's getting them to do things that they would not normally do, thereby excelling in their mission. I just don't see how anyone, especially a military officer, can grow as a leader without that kind of study of great leaders of the past. And for many of you in the room here that are involved in ministry, and many of you are pastors in your local churches, we've had some pretty great religious leaders in this country that have led great revivals in our country. So I would suggest that if you haven't already studied some of those great pastors of the past, maybe you get down to the local library or get you a Kindle and order one online, because those are some great leaders. And I intend to do a little bit more study in that regard, too. Now also, you know, being in a civilian career the last 5.5 years, I've been working for General Dynamics, running some programs from them that support the Army. I also had the opportunity to study some of the captains of industry, and you can learn just as much by studying those folks also. But for me, I love reading about real people and the problems and things that real people have done to lead our nation. Now, allow me to digress just a moment to ask one of those most common questions that I get often about leadership, and I'm sure you've heard this before. And that question is, are leaders made or are they born? Mm. And you know, I've got an absolute answer to that question.
Yes.
They are made and they are born. You know, certain leaders are born with some very important traits, but even those leaders that have natural ability will only become effective through effort, study, and experience. Those less fortunate to be born without some of those traits can become effective leaders through effort, study, and experience. That's what I observed. I'm obviously not 6'5". I may be handsome to some of you, but to most people I'm not. I'm not particularly big. I'm not particularly bold. I don't run real fast. I don't speak real well without a southern accent. So I figured that I better get busy, and to be effective, I better exert some effort, I better study, and I better get some experience.
Amen.
And that's what I tried to do throughout my military career, always going towards those positions of leadership that the Army would allow me to do. Now, just for the record, so I don't offend anybody, when I use the word his, I'm talking about both genders. Just easier rather than just trying to say both or something. I'm talking about both because I have to tell you right now that I have observed some absolutely fantastic female soldiers in the U.S. military. As a matter of fact, during my tour in Iraq as a division commander for the 25th Infantry Division, Tropic Lightning out of Schofield Barracks, Hawaii, I selected a female warrant officer as my command pilot, and she flew me every day. 15 months, except for the time we took about a two-week R&R. Absolutely, without a doubt, the best pilot I've ever seen. And I can tell you, even though I was sitting in the back and I had a whole bank of big radios and everything else, I really couldn't see in the front as I was trying to communicate. But I could tell when the co-pilot was flying and landing that aircraft was a man. Because my pilot, she was smooth, everything was going good. So I could tell, I would joke with them, and on the headset I could speak to them, of course, and I'd say, well, I know who's flying the aircraft. So what's my point about that? We have just as effective female as we do male leaders.
Yes.
And as time goes along, there's more is going to be written about some of the great things that not only women in the military, but women that are leaders in our industry are doing. So when I say, he is, I'm really talking about both genders. So with all that said, what I'd like to do is move on and provide you a couple of excerpts from 30 guiding principles that I developed over time, and that I use these 30 guiding principles every time that I was in command or in staff, from the time that I was a lieutenant colonel. That was when I had about 17, 18 years in the Army, commanding about 1,000 man unit, through brigade command, which is a 5,000 person unit, through division command, which is about an 18,000 person unit, to my last job as a commander of U.S. Army Pacific, which was 46,000 soldiers. And I used these principles and published them. I had observations, I made during a number of things, and I'm going to talk about those guiding principles. But first, I want to share an observation with you about that I observed during my 3 tours in the combat zone. I was blessed to serve my nation in the first Gulf War in Afghanistan and Iraq. And I observed leaders and their leadership traits. And one thing I observed, I'll just call it a fundamental. And that is that a leader that had poor leadership traits during peacetime those traits only got worse during wartime. And I heard some of the military as I was coming up, you know, a person would rise to the task when they went into combat. Not true in my estimation. When there is a personality flaw or an adverse leadership style in a high-stress environment of combat, that flaw really comes to the surface and gets worse. I observed that personally. At that point, it's too late, and it is too dangerous to allow a soldier to do self-correction at the risk of putting other soldiers in jeopardy. So that's the reason it's vitally important in our military, and you're hearing a lot now about the problems with aircraft not flying and people not training and the Army not being able to train if you're following the news. Our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardmen have got to have absolute rigorous training. They have to have the resources to do it. And our leaders have to have the moral courage when they see a leader that is not operating effectively to first counsel, allow them to correct. If they're unable to correct, they have to be moved out. It's just too dangerous a business. And so I observed that a number of times during my career. And you know, it's the same thing I think in business. If you're a leader in a business group, a manager or whatever, and you've got somebody in a lower managerial position and they've got a shortcoming, you walk to them to counsel them and try to develop them. But there comes a point where you're going to have to just allow them to move on so they don't adversely affect your business. So that really goes back to what I said in the first place. A good leader knows their strengths and weaknesses and will capitalize on their strengths and will correct their weaknesses. My second observation in growth as a leader and things that I experienced is that I think a leader's got to be well-grounded in their faith. And, you know, you say, well, what faith? I said, well-grounded in their faith. Because I believe that the faith journey makes them a more confident and more effective leader. Because it does something to the development of the person on the inside. Their morals, their ethics, how they treat other people, and so forth. And I want to say, as I realized that more and more, as I became more mature, trying to develop my own faith journey, I felt it made me a more effective leader. I wish the military would take more time to do that and offer that up to our soldiers and our leaders. You know, I made my way through various levels of command, as I said, I developed 30 principles, and I brought a copy of all 30 of them. I'll be glad to pass them out once we're over here with our question and answer period. I selected just a few and to talk about today, maybe to kind of whet your appetite about our during our discussion period. First of all, number one, spiritual development enhances the whole man. I actually published that. Now, when I first put that out, somebody said, "What are you talking about? You want us to go to chapel or what?" No, I said, "I don't want you. You go to chapel if you want to." But I believe that a human being, especially a soldier, is missing something without spiritual development. And I insisted that the chaplains that worked for me, that they understood that their number one primary task was to offer soldiers the opportunity to enhance themselves spiritually. A variety of ways you can do that. First and foremost, I would tell my chaplains, you're going to be in the field. You're going to be out there in the field with units, and you're going to talk to soldiers one-on-one. They'll feel comfortable in talking to you, and you'll offer other programs so that those soldiers may have a desire to develop themselves personally through their faith. Number two, treat every person with dignity and respect. You know, if a leader wants to be respected, that leader has to respect the people he's leading. And this is not to say that you can't be tough, that you can't demand high standards, because soldiers appreciate that. But you need to do so with great dignity and respect for those that serve under you. Number three, vulgarity is a sign of indiscipline. Eliminate it from your vocabulary. Now I know what you're thinking. Army, Navy, Marines, vulgarity, and that's just a part of the culture. Well, yeah, it is. It's even a part of our everyday culture. I mean, just turn on our TV. Listen to some of the music that's being played. But I published that out and I enforced that, and I believed that a leader is not need to use vulgarity effectively. And the way that I would instruct my non-commissioned officers on this was I ran them through a little drill. I'd bring them up and I'd say, okay, let's say you want to make a correction on a soldier. You can use vulgarity and, you know, and everything else and show disrespect to that soldier and actually demean yourself, or you can simply bring that soldier over, tell that soldier to get in a position of attention, and correct that soldier in a very firm voice, and then give that soldier extra training. That will be much more effective and remembered than you using vulgarity against that soldier. Now, that was a hard line to sell in an airborne infantry battalion. But many of the NCOs, as I was departing, actually came up to me, and I've run into them over the years, and said, sir, you know what? I really didn't buy that vulgarity thing at first. He said, but I know exactly what you mean.
Wow.
And so that was one of the principles that I had. Wow. Number four, listening is an art. You will learn more by listening than talking. Good leader listens to their people. Now, that doesn't mean that everybody gets a vote when you make a decision. But if you're talking to your folks and you're listening to them, you'll know what motivates them. You'll know how to lead them better. I learned a great deal by listening to soldiers. One of the things I like to do, other than talking to individual soldiers in the battalion area, when I was in my last job as a three-star general, lieutenant general, every month I would have a luncheon in my office. And we would bring just the sergeants and the specialists up to my office. And the first thing I'd do, of course, none of them had been in the CG's office, you know, three-star general, so got to put them at ease and talk to them and sit them down and so forth, be friendly. And then we'd close the door and I'd say, okay, what I want you to make sure you understand is anything that you say here to me today is not going to be attributed to you. Not going to come back because they're worried, you know, their senior NCO, you know, you know what I'm talking about. And so I'd get some of the best feedback about just little things that were troubling them about the barracks life, or you know, maybe they're having a problem with the finance, you know, whatever the case may be. I would learn more of that, you know, hour of lunch than I would learn all week from my staff. So then Sergeant Major and I'd get together and we'd figure out how to straighten these things. So, you know, you got to listen. You got to listen to your people. Number five, credit for success belongs to everyone. Credit for failure belongs to us. Number six, maintain a sense of humor. Maintain a sense of humor. No matter what business you're in, whether it be the Army or you're out in business, things can get pretty serious. And not all things are funny, for sure. But if you got a good sense of humor, that can go a long way when times get difficult and stressful. So that was one of the things that I had in there. Number seven, have the courage to fix a problem when you're tired, bored, or scared. And that's something in the military for sure. You're going to be tired. There might be times you might actually be bored, and there's going to be a lot of times that you're scared. And you got to have the courage to fix the problem when you see it and get things moving. Number eight, trust your subordinates. Power down. Trust your subordinates. Power down. An organization that is empowered, people that feel like they're empowered to make decisions, is like an 8-cylinder engine firing on all cylinders. They can get the job done. And you don't have to be present to supervise them and watch over them. That's what really makes a great organization, whether it be a military organization or a business. Number nine. You may prepare a professional lifetime for 100 hours of combat, so stay ready. Now, I was in the first Gulf War, and of course, the Desert Shield portion of that went on for many months, and we were expecting Saddam to do something, and he really didn't do anything. But then the Desert Storm portion kicked off, the offensive phase, and that lasted about 100 hours. About 100 hours. So my point in putting that in my command guidance is that it's too late once you get into combat to get ready. You have to be ready when you go into combat. And so you've got to prepare yourself professionally, and you've got to make sure that your training is realistic and it gets you ready for your mission. Well, I could go on, list the remainder of those things, but you might get bored. And as I said, I'm going to give you a copy of that. But I would just like to simply close by saying, as we open up for questions, that leader development and developing yourself as a leader is a lifetime endeavor. Whether you're leading Army units, or you're out in the civilian sector, whether you're leading your church or your ministry, we always should strive for self-improvement, and we always need to continue to grow as leaders. We don't ever want to become stagnant as leaders. There's always something new that we can learn, whether it be from our subordinates or the people that work from us, or from other great leaders that have gone ahead of us. We can always learn something and improve ourselves as a leader.